reading from canto number 2, chapter number 9, entitled Answers by Citing the Lord's Version. And today we're reading from text number 32.
Yavanaham yatha bhavo
yadrupa
gunakarmaka
tateva
tatva vijnanam Astute madanugrahat.
Translation and purport by His Divine Grace, Srila A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki. Just to give context, this is the final verse before Krishna begins speaking Chatushloki to Lord Brahma. So there's Brahma asks many questions, and then Krishna replies in 6 verses. The 2 verses are the preface, and then the 4 verses are the Chatushloki. So this is the second of the preface verses, and then Krishna will speak Chatushloki. Translation. All of me, namely my actual eternal form and my transcendental existence, color, qualities, and activities, let all be awakened within you by factual mercy. Factual realization out of my causeless mercy. So purport is quite long, just over 2 pages, so I'll read it. Please follow along. Purport. The secret of success in understanding the intricacies of knowledge of the absolute truth, the personality of Godhead, is the causeless mercy of the Lord. Even in the material world, the father of many sons discloses the secret of his position to the pet sons. The father discloses the confidence unto the son whom he thinks worthy. An important man in the social order can be known by his mercy only. Similarly, one must be very dear to the Lord in order to know the Lord. The Lord is unlimited. No one can know him completely. But one's advancement in transcendental loving service of the Lord can make one eligible to know the Lord. Here we can see that the Lord is sufficiently pleased with Brahmaji, and therefore he offers his causeless mercy to him so that Brahma Ji may have the factual realization of the Lord by his mercy only. In the Vedas also it is said that a person cannot know the absolute truth, personality of Godhead, simply by dint of mundane education or intellectual gymnastics. One can know the supreme truth if one has unflinching faith in the bona fide spiritual master as well as in the Lord. Such a faithful person, even though illiterate in the mundane sense, can know the Lord automatically by the mercy of the Lord. In the Bhagavad Gita also it is said that the Lord reserves the right of not being exposed to everyone, and he keeps himself concealed from the faithless by his yoga, maya, potency. To the faithful, the Lord reveals himself in his form, quality, and pastimes. The Lord is not formless as wrongly conceived by the impersonalist, but his form is not like one that we have experienced. The Lord discloses his form even to the extent of measurement to his pure devotees, and that is the meaning of Yavan as explained by Srila Jiva Goswami, the greatest scholar of Srimad-Bhagavatam. The Lord discloses the transcendental nature of his existence. The mundane wranglers make mundane conceptions of the form of the Lord. It is said in the revealed scriptures that the Lord has no mundane form. Therefore, the persons with a poor fund of knowledge conclude that he must be formless. They cannot distinguish between the mundane form and the spiritual form. According to them, without a mundane form, one must be formless. This conclusion is also mundane because formlessness is the opposite conception of form. Negation of the mundane conception does not establish a transcendental fact. In the Brahma Samhita, it is said that the Lord has a transcendental form and that he can utilize any one of his senses for any purpose. For example, he can eat with his eyes and he can see with his leg. In the mundane conception of form, one cannot eat with one's eyes or see with his leg. That is the difference between the mundane body and the spiritual body of Sachit Ananda. A spiritual body is not formless. It is a different type of body of which we cannot conceive with our present mundane senses. Formless, therefore, means devoid of mundane form or possessing a spiritual body of which the non-devotee can have no conception by the speculative method. The Lord discloses to the devotee his unlimited varieties of transcendental bodies, all identical with one another, with different kinds of bodily features. Some of the transcendental bodies of the Lord are blackish, and some of them are whitish. Some of them are reddish, and some of them are yellowish. Some of them are four-handed, and some of them are two-handed. Some of them are like the fish, and some are like the lion. All these different transcendental bodies of the Lord, without any differential category, are disclosed to the devotees of the Lord by the mercy of the Lord. And thus the impersonalist false arguments claiming the formlessness of the Supreme Truth do not appeal to a devotee of the Lord. Even so, such a devotee may be very advanced in devotion, may not be very advanced in devotional service. The Lord has unlimited numbers of transcendental qualities, and one of them is his affection for his unalloyed devotee. In the history of the mundane world, we can appreciate his transcendental qualities. The Lord incarnates himself for the protection of his devotees and for the annihilation of the faithless. His activities are in relationship with his devotees. Srimad-Bhagavatam is full of such activities of the Lord in relationship with his devotees. The non-devotees have no knowledge of such pastimes. The Lord lifted Govardhan Hill when he was only 7 years old and protected his pure devotees at Vrindavan from the wrath of Indra, who was overflooding the place with rain. Now this lifting of the Govardhan Hill by a seven-year-old boy may be unbelievable for the faithless, but for the devotees it is absolutely believable. The devotee believes in the almighty potency of the Lord, while the faithless say the Lord is almighty, but do not believe it. Such men with a poor fund of knowledge do not know that the Lord is the Lord eternally, and that one cannot become the Lord by meditation for millions of years or by mental speculation for billions of years. The impersonal interpretation of the mundane wranglers is completely refuted in this verse, because it is clearly stated that the Supreme Lord has his qualities, form, pastimes, and everything that a person has. All these descriptions of the transcendental nature of the personality of Godhead are factual realizations by the devotee of the Lord, and by the causeless mercy of the Lord, they are revealed to his pure devotee and to no one else. Srila Prabhupada ki, any questions? Interesting. Just as Brahma is about to summarize everything in four verses, just as Krishna is going to summarize it in four verses for Brahma, Prabhupada follow suit. Mahajano yena gata sapanta, you follow in the wake. So yes, Srila Prabhupada has explained many, many things here, revealing so many things in our heart, and the Lord is about to reveal so many things in Brahmaji's heart. That famous saying tells us the two most important days in your life, the day you're born and the day you find out why. So Brahma's about, that day is about to come. Brahma is about to find out why. Why is he here? Why does he exist? What is his purpose? Krishna is going to reveal everything to Brahma. But we have to rewind. It all began on the day Brahma was born, because when Brahma was born, he was completely baffled, and then he heard Tapa, Tapa. Sutta. Austerity, do austerity. And out of humility, pranipat, he accepted, I should do austerity. Austerity, how much? 1 year, 2 years, 1,000 celestial years. This is pranipat. This is submissiveness. The essence of submissiveness is that one is patient. Humility means patience. Because a humble person knows, I'm not worthy. I don't have any qualification. I have no claim, no expectation. So however long it takes, it takes. So we can understand Brahma was humble because he was patient, and he submissively followed the instruction to do austerity, pranipat, tick one box, one mark. But then after he had done his austerity, what did he begin doing? He started asking questions, many, many questions. People have so many, many questions to ask. Yesterday I was at Om Nom doing a program, and at the end of the program, One young lady came up to me and said, I've got a question. I said, yes. She said, what should I look for in my ideal partner? I was like, okay. I wasn't expecting this one, you know. So many questions people have. Very, very interesting. But Brahma's questions, what are the material world? What is the spiritual world? What are the material, spiritual forms of the Lord? He asks so many questions. So therefore, Brahma is asking, Munayo sadupristoham bhavad bir loka mangalam. He's asking questions which will be for the benefit of people, real benefit for generations to come. Therefore, Brahma, pariprashna, asking good questions, give him another mark. And then if you look at Brahmaji's final question, the essence of what he asks right at the end is, and how can I serve you? How can I serve you? That is the ultimate question that one must ask. That is the ultimate mood one must develop, service attitude. Prabhupada said, factually, I met my spiritual master 11 times. I asked him different questions, but actually I only ever asked him one question. And what was the question I only ever asked him? How can I serve you? I may have asked him, should I live here or should I live there? But really I was asking, where's the blessed place from which I can serve? I may ask my spiritual master this ashram or that ashram. Really, I'm asking, where can I serve the best from? So Brahma asks the right questions, and ultimately he has a service mood. So, sevaya, 3 marks. Tadvidi pranipatena pariprashnena sevaya. He completed the circle. He completely was the ideal disciple, because he had pranipat, submission. He was asking the right questions and he had a service mood. This is eternal principle. It never changes. It's spoke about by Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita and is revealed by every single good disciple in the Bhagavatam. That if you do these 3 things, then eventually upadekshanti, you will get initiation, you will get entrance, you will get access, deigyanam, to the highest truths in the universe. Jnaninas tattva darshina. This is what a tattva darshi, a learned person, can give you. So basically, Brahmaji touched Krishna's heart. Parampara means this: the disciple touches the heart of the guru. Because the disciple touches the heart of the guru then opens his heart, reveals his heart. And when the guru reveals the heart, then the disciple understands the heart. And when the disciple understands the heart, his own heart becomes filled with that mood. And then you know what happens? That disciple matures, and in the future, if someone else comes to that good disciple and touches that disciple's heart, then that disciple will reveal their heart. And then the other disciple will understand their heart, and then their heart will become filled. And like this, param para, one after another. Parampara is not just the transfer of knowledge. Yes, of course it's a transfer of knowledge, but ultimately it's a touching of hearts. Every disciple is touching the heart of the guru, and then every subsequent disciple is touching the heart of their guru. And in this way, because the guru is pleased, then one learns truth. You will learn truth from studying scripture. Not alone, because tarko pratishtha shrutayo vibhinna nasha vrishir yasya matam nabhinnam dharmasya tatvam nihitam guhayam mahajano yena gatasupantha. The secrets of dharma are hidden within the hearts of the Vaishnavas. And therefore, one has to somehow get access to the heart, and then one can understand what is actually the truth. In this case, the guru is Krishna. That's good, because dharman tushakshad bhagavat pranitam. Dharma begins from the Lord. So Lord knows dharma. He enunciates dharma. And therefore he is teaching Brahma. So this is parampara. The disciple basically has to touch the heart of the guru. That's what it is. Because if the guru is pleased, then the guru will give everything. And that is basically the tradition of how it all goes on. same thing we see between Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Rupa Goswami. Actually, Kaviraj Goswami draws the parallel between Brahma and Krishna and between Rupa Goswami and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Tene Brahma Rida Ya Adikavaye Muyanti Yat Surayaha. We hear right in the first verse of the Bhagavatam that Krishna, tene, imparting Rida within the heart of Brahma, Brahma Gyan, knowledge, Rida in the heart, Ya Adikavaye, because Brahma is the first created living being, Muyanti Yat Surayaha. And this tattva that Krishna is giving to Brahma within his heart, it's not understandable. It bewilders even the demigods. So this is the line. Tene Brahma Rida Ya Adikavaye Muyanti Yat Surayaha. Kaviraj Goswami says this same line can relate to Rupa Goswami and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Tene, thus Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Brahma, gave Brahma Gyan, but not just Tattva Gyan, he gave Rasa Gyan. He gave Rasa Gyan. Rida, where? Into the heart. Of who? Adikavaye, not just the first created living being, but the original poet. Who's the original poet? Rupa. Rupa Goswami. Muyanti yad surayaha. And this poetry, this knowledge, this rasa gyan has the power to intoxicate the demigod-like devotees. Therefore, Kaviraj Goswami, in the beginning of Rupa Goswami, instructions to Rupa, he cites a very beautiful verse. Vrindavaniyam rasake livartam kalena lupta nijashakti ukta sancharya rupe vyatanot punaya. That these Vrindavan pastimes were lost, so the Lord wanted to recreate the pastimes of Vrindavan in the world, and therefore he imparted within the heart of Rupa Goswami the knowledge by which Rupa could. So Rupa perfectly understood Mahaprabhu's heart. He conquered Mahaprabhu's heart, and therefore Mahaprabhu opened his heart. It's incredible. If you look in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, there's just this scene. You just have to picture it for a moment. It's Jagannath Rath Yatra. Millions of people have come. The atmosphere is at fever pitch. The kirtan is going. Jagannath then comes out. He's intoxicated. Jagannath is moving. And Mahaprabhu is there in the kirtan. Now Rath Yatra has gone to another level because Mahaprabhu is there. Jagannath is there and Mahaprabhu is there. So you can imagine the scene is reaching fever pitch. And as Mahaprabhu catches a sight of Jagannath, he just goes into overdrive of ecstasy. He just doesn't know. He doesn't know what he's feeling, how to express it. So Mahaprabhu has no idea how to express his emotions. So then what Mahaprabhu does is, as he sees Jagannath, he starts reciting this verse. Ya ko mara hara sa eva hivaras ta eva chaitrakshapas. What is the next line? Techon militam malati surabhayo praudha kadamba nila. He starts singing this verse. This is incredible because this is basically mundane poetry. This is just the poetry of the love of a girl for her beloved. Ya koma rahara sa eva hivaras. Yes, that one who was so dear to me, I'm meeting them again. These are the same moonlit nights of Chaitra that we are meeting under. We are meeting again, and it's like the malati flowers are going through the kadamba forest and the breeze is entering my nose. It's just a mundane love song. I mean, you got to imagine, like, imagine this London Rath Yatra. It's fever pitch, you know. And then a shining sannyasi comes who's considered, like, very elevated. And yes, you please lead the kirtan. And as everyone is there in the emotions of Jagannath, imagine they just go on the mic and they start singing a Bollywood song. It's like, call the GBC, you know? I mean, like, so it's bewildering. No one understands. It's a mundane song. It's a completely mundane song. But the thing is, Mahaprabhu doesn't know how to express the emotion that he's feeling for Jagannath. There's no words. So he has to find the closest thing he can find. So he cites this verse. Now everyone is bewildered. They have no idea. What is he singing? Why is he singing? This is some mundane song. But there's one person who goes and thinks about it deeply. And this person, Sri Chaitanya, Manobhishtam, he understands Mahaprabhu's mind. And therefore he composes a mirror verse. And this mirror verse, which comes from Rupa's pen, is considered perhaps his most exquisite verse.
Priya soyam Krishna sah chari kurukshetra militas.
This is very profound. Rupa writes this verse, which basically decodes the whole situation. Everyone is thinking Mahaprabhu is singing some mundane song. Rupa's verse decodes the whole situation because he looks at the scene and he says, I understand everything. Mahaprabhu is in Radhabhav. Jagannath is Krishna in ecstasy. And the whole scene of Jagannath is Kurukshetra. And just as the gopis were trying to pull Krishna, saying, Krishna, you are the same Krishna, but we want to take you to Vrindavan. He's pulling, trying to take him back to Vrindavan. Rupa understood Mahaprabhu is feeling the same thing Radharani was feeling at Kurukshetra. And now he's pulling, he's incomplete, it's the height of his ecstasy. So Rupa, he decoded the whole thing. He wrote it down and he put it in the roof. Mahaprabhu came. Mahaprabhu saw, what's that? Looked at the verse, fainted. How Rupa understood my heart? How could he understand my heart? He slapped him. He slapped him lovingly. And then Mahaprabhu went to Swarup Damodar. He said, how did he understand? Swarup Damodar said, because he touched your heart, therefore you opened your heart. And because you opened your heart, you filled his heart. And because you have filled his heart is now coming out in this verse. Mahaprabhu said, what to do? In these purports, actually, Srila Prabhupada writes, he says, by the grace of Krishna, I was also able to write something which pleased my spiritual master very much. Anyone know what that was? He wrote, Jai Shishi Radha Gokulananda Ki Jai Sitaram Lakshman Hanuman Ki Jai. Srila Prabhupada once wrote a Vyasa Puja offering. Prabhupada was a real, they used to call him Kavi. He was a real poet. Srila Prabhupada's words were so poetic. And once he wrote a stanza in a poem. And when Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur read that stanza, he said, he has understood me. Prabhupada wrote in one stanza, absolute is sentient, thou hast proved, impersonal calamity, thou hast moved. And when Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur read that, he said, he understood me completely. He understood my mission, the complete annihilation of Mayavad. I won't stand for anything less than that. I want to strike them out completely. So Prabhupada said, you proved it. Absolute is sentient. So Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, he would often show that verse to people who came. He said, just see, he's understood my heart. Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur had a magazine, The Harmonist, and he said to the editor, after he read Prabhupada's verse, he said to the editor, whatever he writes, just publish it. No need to check it. Just publish it. Because he has understood my heart. The disciple must understand the heart of the guru. This is tradition. Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur understood the heart of Gaur Kishordas Babaji, isn't it? He was completely aligned, completely on the same wavelength. Even once, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur gave a lecture and he said, my spiritual master, Gaur Kishordas Babaji, he gave me three instructions. Instruction number one, never make any disciples. Instruction number two, never associate with materialistic people. Instruction number three, never go to Calcutta. Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati said, I followed him perfectly. Really? He said, people think I made so many disciples, but I never made any disciples. I saw all of them as representatives of my spiritual master. I saw all of them had come to instruct me. He said, people think I associated with many materialistic people, but association means you take something from someone. But when I associated with all these people, I never took anything. I was just giving. And he said, I never went to Calcutta, because whenever I went to Calcutta, I stayed in Bagh Bazar temple. And that's not of this realm. That's in the spiritual world. I followed my spiritual master perfectly. I understood his heart. So Brahma understood Krishna's heart. Rupa understood Mahaprabhu's heart. Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur understood Gaur Kishordas Babaji's heart. Srila Prabhupada understood Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur's heart. That is how parampara goes on. We must touch the heart of our superiors, and then they open their heart, and then we understand their heart. So we have to, just like we're reading how Brahma just became such a wonderful disciple, we also have to become worthy. We have to touch the hearts. Sometimes in order to know how to become a good disciple, it can help to know what is a bad disciple. Because the good things we know, like Sevaya, Prashna. But what does a bad disciple mean? Actually, there's a verse given in Shastra of six types of bad disciple. So you can see maybe some of these mentalities come in that need to be avoided. Alir bano jyotishaka stabdibhuta kimekaka preshikas preshakas cheva sadete sevakadhamma sadete. There are six kinds, sevakadhamma, of inferior disciple. Are you interested? Want to know? What are the six types of inferior disciple? The first one is Ali. Ali means a bee. Bee-like disciple. Why is a bee-like disciple inferior? Because a bee just goes from flower to flower, buzzing around, getting a bit of nectar from here, getting a bit of nectar from there, but a bee is not committed anywhere. A bee is basically the sign of fickleness, the sign of someone who can give up their affection and attachment for someone very, very easily. So sometimes some disciples are like that. There's a dramatic show of surrender. And Gurudev, from this day on, till the end of eternity, I will. And then after some time, nowhere to be seen. That is the fickleness of the bee-like disciple. So we should understand that the good disciple has great loyalty, has great chastity. Not my spiritual master, I can never leave. I can never leave my spiritual master. How much he has given me. Just like Srila Prabhupada was in San Francisco, 67. He became very sick. He had to go back to India. The devotees were thinking, well, how are we going to survive without Srila Prabhupada? So someone made a suggestion. Srila Prabhupada, maybe when you go back, you can bring one of your god brothers to act as your temporary replacement. And Mukunda Maharaj tells the story that Prabhupada just was very quiet. And Prabhupada said, my spiritual master was no ordinary spiritual master. He saved me. And then Prabhupada began crying. And then the devotee realized, oh my God, how could we even have thought of that? that someone could replace Srila Prabhupada. Prabhupada said he was no ordinary spiritual master. The bee-like disciple doesn't understand this. They don't understand how much they were invested with, how much mercy they received. You can never leave. So the first lower disciple is the bee-like disciple, Alir. Then the second lower type of disciple, Bana, isn't it? Bana, Pushpa, Krishna is known, Krishpa, Pushpa Banaya. Bana means an arrow. The second type of inferior disciple is like an arrow. Why? Because that disciple actually pierces the heart of the guru, not in a good way. By their words and their deeds, they cause pain to the spiritual master. Prabhupada said, you took vows in front of Agni, you took vows in front of the Vaishnavas, you took vows in front of Krishna, in front of the guru, you must honor them. That is gentleman, that is noble. So when the disciple acts in a way which is in violation of the guru's direction, then he becomes like an arrow disciple. Instead of going out to fight Maya and declare war on illusion, he aims those arrows back at the guru and shoots the guru. Prabhupada said, I'm suffering so much because my disciples are not following. So then Shastra says, this is the second type of inferior disciple, Bana, and like an arrow. And then the third type of inferior disciple, Jyotishaka. Understand? Jyotishaka. What's Jyotish? Astrology. Third type of inferior disciple is the astrologer disciple. Have you ever heard of the astrologer disciple? The astrologer disciple is ready. Yes, yes, I've got my instructions from Guru Maharaj. I'm ready to do it. I'm ready, but everything just has to be aligned properly. This planet has to be in the seventh house, and then this has to be rising. This influence has to be extinguished. The nakshatra has to be like this. And everything is perfect. Then I'll do. This is called Jyotishaka, the astrologer disciple, the one who's waiting for that day when everything is perfect to then execute the order of the spiritual master. Everything must be in place, everything must be favorable, and then I'll do it. Did Prabhupada wait? Prabhupada didn't have good health. Prabhupada had no money. Prabhupada had no contacts. Prabhupada had... He had no strategy. Nothing was in place, in one sense. But he went. Sometimes you think Srila Prabhupada's life was specifically engineered so that no one can have any more excuses not to do it. Because you can't say, oh, my health is bad, because Prabhupada had two heart attacks. You can't say, well, I don't have so much material security. Well, Prabhupada had 40 rupees in his pocket. You can't say, well, I don't have the support of many, many people around me. Well, Prabhupada had no one with him. So the third type of inferior disciple is the Jyotishaka, the one who tries to wait till everything's perfect. And what happens? Ayur harati vaipum sham. The sun rises, the sun sets, and while the disciple is waiting for the ideal time, life is taken away and has to come back all over again and implicate the spiritual master in that negligence. Fourth type of inferior disciple, shtabdi bhuta, which literally means lazy, lazy intelligence, lazy disciple. A disciple who knows I should what they're supposed to do. They know they should do it. They know that everything is the right time to do it, but somehow or other just can't generate the energy, the momentum, the enthusiasm to do it. The best disciple can't bear to waste their energy. Srila Prabhupada just spent every last bit of energy to serve Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur. No stone left unturned. Srila Prabhupada just was the complete antithesis of laziness. Like his spiritual master told him, preach in the English language, so he could have written one article, but he didn't. He wrote 60 volumes. He could have opened one temple, but he didn't. He opened 108. He could have preached in one country, but he didn't. He went around the world 14 times. He could have initiated one disciple. So many things. He could have just done it, but he just went more and more and more and more and more. Completely awake, not lazy, utilizing his energy. Once Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur was giving a lecture and he said something which pierced Srila Prabhupada's heart. He said, I wish that every selfless, tender-hearted member of the Gaudiya Math be willing to shed 200 gallons of blood for the upliftment of the spiritual corpus of the entire universe. That was Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur's expectation, 200 gallons of blood. If you look on the internet, actually, there's one man who actually donated 200 gallons of blood. He's in the Guinness Book of Records. He's in Seattle. There was one man who actually underwent 700 blood transfusions. And in his life, or blood, whatever you call it, and over his lifetime, he actually donated 200 gallons of blood. It was very noble. But was it really for the upliftment of the spiritual corpus of the entire humanity? Maybe not. That was Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur's expectation. Be willing to shed 200 gallons of blood. It's got to be on your mind. Is it on our minds when we wake up in the morning? How are we going to spread this movement? Is it on our minds when we go to bed at night? How are we going to fulfill Srila Prabhupada's dreams? That is disciple. Otherwise, shtabdi bhuta, lazy disciple. Fourth type of inferior disciple. Fifth type of inferior disciple, kimeika ka. This is very interesting. Kimeka ka. One name of a servant in Sanskrit is Kinkara, isn't it? Kinkara literally means, what shall I do? Kimeka ka literally means what? Just me? What? Me alone? This is the fifth type of inferior disciple. They look around and they see no one's doing it. So why should I do it alone? I'm not going to do it. Have you ever met, like sometimes we're in that mentality, well, no one's doing it, therefore why should I do it? No one's doing it, why should I do it? Whereas a real disciple says, no one's doing it, I should do it. And then I should try to encourage and inspire others to also do it. Kimeika ka. This type of disciple looks around and always goes to the lowest common denominator. Oh no, others are not doing it, therefore I don't do it. Why should I do alone? Why do I have to make a special effort? No. If Srila Prabhupada did that, that would have been a disaster. But Srila Prabhupada said, no one is doing it. Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur's spirit, his mission has been lost. After his demise, everyone is fighting over this room, that room, over this thing, that thing. Everyone has lost the spirit. He could have just said, oh, no one is doing, why? Kimeika ka, why I do alone? No, I will do alone. I will do it. I'll take it on my head. And then Prabhupada invited everyone, come and join, let us do it together. It is not my credit, it's for everyone. This is our spiritual master's order. So fifth type of inferior disciple, kimeika ka, the one who looks around and says, well, anyway, it's all right, no one's doing it. It's not practical. It's not. It's there, but no one's really doing it, so relax, it's fine. No. And fifth type of inferior disciple, preshita, preshakas. This is called pass the buck disciple. They know all the instructions of the guru.
But they always pass them on to others, pass on the instructions to others. Yes, yes, I'm a treasure house of instructions. Problem is, I don't follow any of them myself, but I can tell you what to do. So there are some people, even Srila Prabhupada said this, so many people are criticizing me, this has not been done, that has not been done. But what have they done to spread Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur's movement? So everyone has millions of instructions that they can share with the world. Everyone is full of the world today, where everyone knows what Srila Prabhupada said, and everyone makes it a point to tell everyone else what Srila Prabhupada said. But then we have to ask ourselves, am I doing it myself? No, I mean, that's there, but we should make sure everyone knows. Yeah, everyone should know, and you should also do. Otherwise, why you just tell everyone? Criticizing, saying, you know, this has not been done, that has not been done. But what have you done? Therefore, a good disciple is not like this, passing the buck. It's easy to be the driver when you're in the passenger seat. Well, why don't you get out of the passenger seat and get into the driver's seat and start driving the car and follow the instruction? Don't just be pass the buck disciple and tell everyone else what to do. No, we should follow ourselves. So like this, Shastra is telling us so many ways. To become a good disciple is not a small thing. Srila Prabhupada is telling us through his purpose to become a good disciple is the secret of success in spiritual life. And to become a good disciple means you have to overcome these tendencies of disloyalty like the bee, of deviation like the arrow, of procrastination like the astrologer-like disciple, of the lethargy of the lazy disciple, of the constant comparison of the disciple who looks around and says, why me alone? And of the, we have to overcome also the tendency to be all talk, no action, the pass the buck disciple. These things have to be overcome. Otherwise, one has become a good disciple. How you will touch the heart of your spiritual master? So many of Srila Prabhupada's disciples, they touch the heart of Prabhupada. This philosophy that the Guru Parampara ends with Srila Prabhupada, it makes no sense on so many levels. But the amazing thing about why it really doesn't make sense is because Parampara carries on because disciples have touched the heart of their Guru and their Guru has revealed their hearts. If someone says the Parampara stopped at Srila Prabhupada, that means they're saying no one touched Prabhupada's heart. That Prabhupada felt no one, that he was not pleased enough with anyone to reveal his heart and give his empowerment to them. Prabhupada was crying when he talked about his disciples and he said, they've given up everything for me, how can I repay them? Prabhupada's disciples touched his heart and therefore Prabhupada empowered them and their hearts became filled, and like this we serve them. And then we become filled, and then we humbly try to offer that down the line. This is parampara, evam parampara praptam. This is how it goes on. Prabhupada said, like one carriage pulls another carriage, and they pull each other, and the whole train goes back home, back to Godhead. This is parampara. So Brahmaji just satisfied Krishna by his service, by his inquiries, by his humility. He did full circle, everything, and therefore Krishna was so pleased. Yasya deve para bhaktir yatha deve tatha guru. That verse tells us that you have to have implicit faith in the spiritual master as much as Krishna. In Brahmaji's case, it was easier because Krishna was simultaneously the spiritual master, so two in one. So he pleased Krishna, and therefore, dashyayate katita hyartha, all the conclusions of Vedic literature, prakashante mahatmana, were immediately revealed within his heart. And so this is our tradition, this is the tradition of Vaishnav community, that the parampara must go on. And the parampara goes on because knowledge is transferred and hearts are touched. And by this combination, there's hope in the world, there's light in the world, and there's opportunity in the world for the conditioned souls to go back home, back to Godhead, if they tap in to that line of wonderful teachers. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Maybe we can take a few questions if anyone has. Yes.
Hare Krishna Maharaj. I was wondering if someone criticized Srila Prabhupada that he was waiting too long to execute his spiritual master instruction to go to the West. How can we justify his decision and defend him?
The spiritual master's instruction can never be denied, but it may be delayed. But even when the disciple is delaying the spiritual master's instruction, they are always investing and moving towards fulfillment of that instruction. We cannot say Srila Prabhupada was procrastinating to come to the West. He would have only been procrastinating if in that time between 1922 and 1966, he wasn't thinking, he wasn't planning, he wasn't positioning himself in such a way that eventually he could fulfill that instruction. If in a disciple's life they can't fulfill the instruction, but that instruction is constantly on their mind, they're doing other things in their life which will ultimately empower them to fulfill those instructions, and they ultimately have a vision of where to position themselves so that they can fulfill that instruction, then even though they may not have fulfilled that instruction, in another sense they are still in pursuance of that instruction, and therefore they're still an ideal disciple. So Srila Prabhupada delayed it, because as Satsvarup Maharaj writes in his biography, a lifetime in preparation. Prabhupada showed us the ideal example. Prabhupada in 1959 went to Vrindavan. By that time he was already 63. He knew he had to spread Krishna consciousness all over the world, but he decided, I'm going to stay at Radha Damodara temple for 6 years. Think, like, time is going. But Prabhupada thought it important enough, let me take shelter. Let me take shelter at the lotus feet of Rupa Goswami. Let me beg. Let me pray. Let me become empowered. Let me develop the shakti in order to do this service. And therefore, Prabhupada was preparing himself, showing us an example of how we should always be preparing ourselves to fulfill the instruction. So in that way we can say Prabhupada was not the Jyotishaka. Because the Jyotishaka, the one who's just waiting for the perfect arrangements, they're using that basically as a scapegoat. They're using that basically because they actually in their heart, they have no intention. They have no desire. They have no enthusiasm actually to fulfill the instruction. It's just there. But no, for Prabhupada it was on his mind. Prabhupada said, I was initiated the first moment I saw Bhaktisiddhanta, I accepted him in my heart. So Prabhupada was such a vessel. He touched the heart and his heart was touched. Therefore he touched the hearts of so many around the world. I hope that helps. Yeah.
Thank you for the class, Maharaj. Amongst senior devotees, sometimes there's differences of opinion. Many of the times it's presented as if it's not quite clear what Prabhupada said and what should be done. So then, in that situation, even though the younger devotees want to serve, they're put into confusion because the differences of opinion between the seniors. So then, how should we approach that, or how should we, have the right mood and understanding?
Spiritual world is full of variety. Even in the spiritual world, there are differences of opinion. Even amongst acharyas, there are different perspectives. Even we say, if Bhagavatam, prati shloke, prati akshare, nana arthakai, in every word there are so many meanings. Spiritual life is multidimensional, and therefore there can be multiple approaches, multiple considerations, multiple viewpoints. Some of that comes from spiritual diversity, and some of that can also sometimes come from a more material and mundane reasoning. But the fact of the matter is, yes, there are differences. On every single issue within ISKCON, there are multiple. Once we went to the GBC college and His Holiness Devamrita Maharaj gave a seminar, and it was entitled Navigating the Ocean of Opinions. So it's an ocean of opinions. Everyone has an opinion. Everyone has an idea. This is what Prabhupada is. Everyone has their own Srila Prabhupada, isn't it? For some people, Prabhupada was the kind, loving, liberal, flexible, kind-hearted sadhu. And for others, Prabhupada was the chopper, the uncompromising person who spoke out in defiance of all materialistic ideology without compromise, harder than a thunderbolt. Which one is he? Both, because Prabhupada's character is so multidimensional. So ultimately, the first thing is that we have to, in our society, just be able to find unity in diversity. And it's not that every disagreement has to be an argument. That's the first problem. The first problem is when we have different opinions and therefore we start casting aspersions. Oh my God, that person's got a different opinion from me. Clearly they're not chanting their rounds. Clearly they are their spiritual status has now come into question. Clearly, because they have a different opinion to me. I mean, how is it possible? No, because they say, there is your version of the truth, there's my version of the truth, and then there's the truth. And maybe everyone's grasped a different aspect of the truth in their own way. So the first thing is we have to learn in our society that every disagreement doesn't have to be an argument. We have to sometimes learn to live with diversity and have what we call samanvaya, which is proper reconciliation of differences. The first aphorism of Vedanta is atato brahma jigyasa, you should inquire about the supreme truth. The second aphorism of Vedanta is janmadyasya yataha, that absolute truth is from whom everything emanates. The third aphorism of Vedanta is shastra yonitvat, if you want to understand the absolute truth, you have to go to shastra. And the fourth aphorism is tattu samanvaya, which means you'll have to reconcile. Because Shastra is complex, spiritual reality is complex. There's so many opinions, so we have to be able to engage in proper discussion to reconcile. So, what do we do? Because there are many, many opinions above us. We respect everyone, and then we may accept a certain line of thought, a certain personality or personalities in whom we feel a sajatiya, like-mindedness with, and then we follow in their wake. But that doesn't mean we form a clique and then strike out everyone else who has a different opinion. No, if that's your realization that this is what Prabhupada wanted and these teachers are presenting it in that way and you feel very much resonating with that, by all means do it and give your life to Srila Prabhupada. But don't try and don't be aggressive and create animosity amongst others who may have a valid but different opinion. That we have to learn the art of doing that. That's why Srila Prabhupada said, find unity in diversity. So Guru Sadhu Shastra is so complex and it requires very, very
very, very mature people to be able to navigate that without creating disunity and disharmony. And so, ultimately we should not say, oh, everyone is saying different things, therefore I should follow nothing. It's too confusing because everyone's saying different things. No, everyone's saying different things, that's okay. Now you find who you have sajatiya and snigdhasya, you have some affection and some relationship in some teachers, and then follow, because you have to follow. That's our path, that we have to follow the Vaishnavas. I don't know if you want to respond. Is that okay? You want to say something? No? Okay.
Hare Krishna Maharaj, thank you for the class. We often hear a lot about, the importance of Vani and following the instructions of the spiritual master. I was just wondering, does Vapu also play an important role for the disciple? And should that be a factor for one who's, trying to choose a spiritual master?
Everything is individual. Everyone's a different person. Srila Prabhupada met his spiritual master 11 times. He didn't have so much Vapu association. Everyone is a different person and may require a different thing. So as a disciple, if you feel, as a prospective disciple, that having personal time and personal training is an important part of the relationship for you, then you put emphasis on that. But someone equally may feel that the instructions given in public classes, even they may not have interaction, is sufficient for them to be inspired. So that's also fine. There's no hard and fast rule. The guru-disciple relationship is not stereotyped. Everyone does it in a different way, but it's a principle that stands. No one became a great Vaishnav without serving another great Vaishnav. No one in this line of spiritual teachings was self-made. One has to take shelter. And then you have to ask yourself, what will it take for me to take shelter? And then you try to then make a decision based on that. Yes, Vishwamba Guru.
Hare Krishna. I just, with your permission, will make a little comment on the difference opinion. In the Bhagavatam, there is a passage where Srila Prabhupada said that the tangible proof that we are all individuals, that that everyone has a different opinion.
Mm.
And Prabhupada said this will clarify, will establish, personalism over impersonalism. Otherwise, if everybody has
the same
opinion, we are there is no God, then we are all God. So Krishna has given us, that it's a very nice purport. I can't remember, the reference, but I just wanted to elaborate a little bit more that the problem is that there is nothing. It's good, to have a different opinion. We can differ in details, but not in principles.
Mm-hmm.
The problem is that we don't just express opinions. We have a tendency. This is a tendency for everybody in this world. Rarely I find someone who has expressed the opinion and then they're detached from it.
Mm.
But the problem is, that we become judges as well. Mm. We start to, we're surrounded. ISKCON is full of judges. So many judges. And that's why there is a conflict. It's not the opinion the problem, but it's the, when we start to judge.
Holding to a certain viewpoint and
exactly.
Judging others if they don't hold the same.
And then, we become not just judge, but also executor. So we put in all the heart and the feeling, and we waste so much time, you know, in castrating and killing the reputation of other devotees. I mean, it's in general, in every religions, in every, Jesus Christ was crucified because of that. So I think it will be a great lesson if the devotees, they can express their feeling, but without judgmental
others.
Reaction.
Mm. Thank you.
Hare Krishna.
Yeah, that's beautiful. I think Panchatattva had a... I'll just make a comment on just before Panchatattva. To stay unified, to stay cooperative, it's so difficult in this age. In our movement, we're losing so much energy because of differences of opinion and infighting. Nowadays, it's so like we start different projects, and every time I start, or we start some kind of project, I'm just like, always have mixed feelings, because I'm like, okay, now we're going to start a whole thing which is going to create, you know, fighting and differences of opinions and friction. And whenever individuals seem to get together, it's just so difficult to get along with each other and respect each other. So we really, really have to work on that in our movement. It's really debilitating us so much. It's really debilitating us so much, all this infighting. So yeah, thank you for raising that point. Yeah, just the last comment and then we'll wrap up. Is that okay? Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Maharaj. With this pastime of Rupa Goswami, you see, he was somewhat unique that he knew the mind of Mahaprabhu, but then by his mercy, we're able to also perceive a glimpse of the mind of Mahaprabhu. So similarly, the necessity of us to... Because he has a sort of elevated position amongst the disciples of Mahaprabhu. Similarly with the relationship with our own spiritual master, do we need to occupy this such a high position? Or is it acceptable to access the spiritual master through his disciples who perhaps understood him better?
I don't quite understand the... Like, so you're saying, should... I don't quite understand the question. Should we try to understand the guru directly, or should we try to understand the guru through the disciples of the guru who may be more...
Yes.
Both. You go in front of Krishna every day and you pray to Krishna. And at the same time you pray to the Vaishnava and you say, Krishna se tomar, Krishna dite paro, tomara shakati ache. Krishna is yours, you give me Krishna. And then you go in front of Krishna and you say, Krishna, I'm yours, you take me. We pray to Krishna and we pray to the Vaishnavas. We need all the help we can get. We approach directly and we approach through others. So just like we get Krishna in that way. You want to understand Guru? Yes, you have to hear from Guru. Like, you have to read Prabhupada's books. You have to read all of Prabhupada's books. You have to read all of Prabhupada's letters. You have to read all of his conversations. You have to read all of his diaries. Sorry, me also. You have to know Prabhupada for yourself. And then you can also hear from others who knew Prabhupada. And then at the end of the day, you have your relationship with Srila Prabhupada. So then on that, if we would use that logic, then no one's allowed to read Prabhupada's books. We should just hear from those who know Prabhupada. And then just understand from... And no, we try to understand. Who can understand Prabhupada? Vaishnavera kriya mudra vikyena, but you kind of understand Vaishnava, but we try. So yes, we approach Guru directly, we hear from them, we try to catch the spirit, what's important to them, what was on their mind, what was moving their every endeavor in this world, what were they concerned about? And then we also hear from those who are close, and we say, what did they reveal to you? And what did you glean from your association with them? And by that dual effort, then maybe you get some entrance into understanding the heart, and then you have to touch the heart.